Good evening, everyone. We are so happy that you're here with us. We welcome you back to our Holy Spirit Emphasis Week, where our theme for this week is Kingdom Blessing of the New Covenant. And we're talking about blessing. And so once again, this evening we have our Elder Auckland Fleming, who is going to speak to us about blessings on the pure in heart. So if you want to know what it is to be pure in heart and how you can be blessed as one who is pure in heart, we ask that you stay tuned. We ask that you invite someone to join us. And as you've been blessed for the rest of the past nights of this week, we know that you will truly be blessed tonight again. So thank you for joining us, and may the Lord continue to bless you.
Just suppose God searched through heaven, couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed, that would buy eternal life for you and me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul was willing to drink his bitter cup. Although he prayed, "Father, let this pass from me," and I'm so glad he never called heaven's angels. From these hands, pull the nails that set me free. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. Then forever my soul would be lost.
Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be your name. We praise you, for you are God and God alone. You sit on your throne, declaring that all the other gods are idols. They are the work of man's hand, but you create heaven and earth. We thank you so much for giving your only Son, Jesus Christ. whereby we can have salvation and have it so full and free. We thank you so much, Jesus, for coming here and identifying with us. Thank you for the many promises you have made. You promise us that you will not leave us comfortless. You will send the Comforter, who is the Holy Spirit. And you promise to us that he will abide with us forever. So, Holy Spirit, breathe upon us a breath of God. Fill us with life anew. That we may do the things you want us to do. We will say the things you want us to say. And that we will go where you want us to go. We thank you so much, Jesus, for the promise of your soon return. You are preparing a place for your people. We thank you for the words of assurance that has been spoken night to night. And even tonight, will be no exception. We pray that it's only your Spirit that can make us pure in heart. You promise that he is our Comforter. We pray that you'll pour upon him, the speaker this evening, even Elder Fleming. We pray that you'll enlighten his mind. Give him the mind of Jesus. And for those who are listening, we do pray that you'll bless them in a special way. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for comforting those that mourn at this time. Jesus, you are the answer for the world today. So we ask that you will bless those who need it most. We thank you for your promise that you'll return one of these days. In spite of what we are going through, there is a better day coming. A day when Jesus promised he'll make all things new. He'll give us a new body. Where shall only dwell righteousness. Above all, we thank you for the forgiveness of sin. We pray that you will continue to heal those that have broken hearts, those who have lost loved ones, those who are confused and concerned, oh, that they'll turn their hearts upon Jesus. And as they look into your wonderful face, truly the things of earth will go strangely dim in the light of his glory and of his grace. So we thank you again for your wonderful promise that one of these days you will tabernacle with us, we will dwell with you, and throughout eternity there'll be no need for prayer, but just to praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. We thank you for hearing and for answering our prayer in the wonderful, blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, and our soon coming King. Amen.
Good evening. Tonight our topic is Blessing and the Pure in Heart by Sister Mary Rosemary Desire. What does it mean to be pure in heart? According to GotQuestions.org, to be pure means to be clean, blameless, unstained from guilt. The word can refer specifically to that which is purified by fire or by pruning. Matthew 3:11 indicates that Jesus was baptized with the Holy Spirit and fire. Malachi 3:2 speaks of the Messiah as being like a refiner's fire. In John 15:1-17, Jesus refers to the believers as being the branches and to himself as being the vine. For a vine to produce fruit, it must be pruned. To those who are truly pure, those who have been declared innocent because of the work of Jesus and are being sanctified by his refining fire and his pruning. Let us look at the word heart. This can be applied to the physical heart, but it also refers to the spiritual center of life. It is where thoughts, desires, sense of purpose, will, understanding, and character reside. The Bible authors give the word a much broader meaning than modern languages attribute to it today. We usually link the heart with emotions, but in the Bible, it designates the inward man, the intimate, hidden areas of the being, the center of emotions, and the intellect. From the heart, good and evil thoughts issue, and in and in those resolutions take shape that determine human destiny. When Jesus speaks of the new heart, he means the mind, the life, the being. Pruning by fire is beautifully illustrated in the book The Coming of the Comforter by Leroy Froom. It says that in old Dalmatia, houses are made of brick bituminous limestone, which is soft and easy to cut and shape. However, the finished house is uninhabitable because of the strong odor of bitumen. To purify it, the building is set on fire. The fire sucks the bitumen from the pores of the saturated stone until everything combustible passes away in gas and smoke, and then the fire flickers and dies for lack of fuel. The house now smells sweet and clean and has the appearance of white marble. If it were to be in the midst of a fire, it would not burn, as there is nothing combustible left. The house represents each one of us. We are plagued by the bitumen of sin. The only escape route is to be baptized by fire so that all our dross is consumed and our hearts made pure. This will make us fireproof against the day that will burn like an oven. The passage under consideration indicates that the pure in heart will see God. Seeing that the heart of man is naturally deceitful and desperately wicked, how does one get to the purity necessary to see God? To understand the wickedness of man, or the wickedness of man's heart a little better, just take a look at some recent headlines from around the world. Identical triplets jailed for the same crime. When law enforcement lacks humanity. TSU constable robbed of bicycle. Only months on the job, prison officer gunned down. Beloved taxi driver shot dead at the wheel while driving. Witnesses say she was raped over and over. Woman sentenced for killing daughters who got in the way of her social life. These are just a few. No matter what country or combination of countries you check, the news is basically the same. This sounds like a description of the antediluvian world. Genesis 6:5 says, "And God saw the wickedness of man was great in the heart, was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." So how does one receive a pure heart? I'm reminded of a simple yet profound story. A family bought a house. A few weeks later, they noticed a black spot on the ceiling. As the days went by, the spot got bigger and bigger, until it was so unsightly that they bought some paint and painted it. Sometime later, it was back again. One more time, they painted it over again. This did not stop. It was just a matter of time before it came back every time it was painted. Eventually, the family decided to get to the heart of the matter. They found someone who could get on the roof and figure out what was the problem. To their surprise, there was a leak on the roof. Every time it rained, the water would settle on that spot, causing mildew and discoloration. After the leak was fixed, the problem disappeared. This is very much like the unregenerated heart. We must surrender completely and allow God to make us over. Purity is demanded not only in the outward life, but in the secret intents and emotions of the heart. In other words, purity of the heart is not something we acquire by making superficial efforts on our own. It comes with making a total and complete surrender to God, thus giving him permission to take away our old stony heart and give us a brand new heart, a pure heart. Painting over our old habits will not do. We need a complete makeover which God alone can give. Being pure in heart involves having singleness of heart toward God. A pure heart has no hypocrisy, no guile, no hidden motives. The pure heart is marked by transparency and an uncompromising desire to please God in all things. It is more than eternal purity of behavior. It is the eternal purity of the soul. Jesus was not referring to ceremonial purity, but rather inward cleanness, purity of motives. Those with pure hearts have forsaken sin as the ruling principle in their life, and their lives are without reserve consecrated to God. To be pure in heart does not mean that one is absolutely sinless, but it does mean that his motives are right. that by the grace of God, he has turned his back on past mistakes and that he's pressing toward the mark of perfection in Christ Jesus. When we have achieved purity of heart, a blessing awaits us. We shall see God. The Bible says in Exodus 33:20 that no man can see God and live. The seeing, therefore, refers to a better understanding of God and seeing him work in our lives. We will certainly experience a greater joy in our lives when we have confessed our sins, drawn near to God, and seek to live his way rather than ours. We will see God in the sense that we can clearly understand his plans for our lives and walk in a way that pleases him. When we are pure in heart, we'll be closer to God than if we live impure lives. It also means salvation eventually. The Christian's noblest and highest aspiration is to see God for himself and live in his presence in the presence of his eternity. The Bible is an unerring guide. It demands perfect purity in word, in thought, and in action. Only virtuous and spotless characters will be permitted to enter the presence of a pure and holy God. The pure in heart live as in the visible presence of God during the time he appoints them in this world. And they will see his face, they'll see him face to face in the future, immortal state, as did Adam when he walked and talked with God in Eden. Thoughts on the Mount of Blessing, page 45. And that has brought us to the end of our presentation this evening. I hope that it blessed you and may it find a role in your life. In Jesus' name, amen.